So welcome to the Sitch then, and this is another one of the RH Fisheries waters, and it's another spectacular venue. Totally enclosed in trees, loads of massive fish, no reception on your phone, and just the perfect place to come down to for a 48 hour session. And it's early March now, conditions look good, there's fish coming out, so it's now just a case of trying to find a swim and see if we can catch a few fish. Check out that scenery. This place is absolutely stunning. It's roughly 26 acres, and out there is about 130 pound carp, the biggest of which goes to 50 pounds 8 ounces, I think. It was 50 a few weeks ago. But regardless of what the stocks are like, that is just a beautiful place to be. And it's no wonder that tickets to fish here are really sought after. So this is the swim I've decided to go in. This is peg 12, and I've decided to put the bivvy right up here in the forest, which is well away from where you're actually putting your rods, because there's a board down there where you've got your rods on the end. Now I could fit a bivvy on the end of that if I wanted to, but if I'm honest, I don't like doing that, because when you're on a board, you've only got to sort of move or make any sort of sound and it just transfers straight into the lake. And to me, you're better off back here. You know, it's not too far to get to my rods if they go, but I've also got all this lovely forest behind me, which is just gorgeous. But yeah, the reason I've gone in here is because I've seen some fish just out in front. I just spent about half an hour or so watching, and you know, it's early March now and it's getting warm. There's fish getting caught. I know there's a few fish getting caught from out in the middle. And I only sort of spent half an hour or so just gazing out there, and I started seeing just fish below the surface. There's one there, just see it right in the swim. You know, there's definitely carp around here. Now you do tend to get a lot of fish caught from right in that middle area. I know that's where the biggin was caught a few weeks back. I know it's also where a lad has just caught one of the 40 pound commons from out in the middle as well. So that seems to be the best area, because it does get some pressure on this water. You see a lot of anglers on here, and because it's quite shallow, they tend to congregate right out in the middle. So that's what I'm going to do. Get a couple of rods set up and get them whacked out to the middle. This is the time of the year when you can't beat a wafter. So I've been down at the DNA factory and picked up some SLK wafters, some Secret 7, some of the new crayfish ones, some Nutter S, and I've got loads of glugs as well. But the one that I'm going to go for today, the ever reliable SLK. It's early March, so the fish are just waking up, and there's no need to put loads of bait out, so it's just going to be single hook bait fishing. So I'm going to get one of these, which is glugging in some food dip. They've been in there for a few weeks now. They don't smell lovely, but hopefully they will do to the carp, and then whack it out to the middle of the lake. This is where it all starts, because I've had a really busy weekend and I've been dashing around all day today, driving to the lake. Roads are really busy and lake's been quite busy as well by the looks of it, and just managed to get the rods out. I found some fish, so I'm happy with those. I've got the bivvy up, I've got the chair in place. This is where it all starts. You can start to relax, because I've got 48 hours ahead of me now and feeling really confident, because there's been a few fish out and there's definitely a few of them in front of me. Conditions look good as well, and it's nice to be sat down, because I've had a real busy weekend. I entered my first ever 10k race this weekend. Do quite a lot of running. You've probably seen that on one or two of my blogs, but I actually do quite a lot of marathon running and half marathons, and don't really do any shorter distances. So I've been training for Parish Marathon for the last 12 weeks and hoping to break that 3 hour barrier. So I put a lot of effort into that, but that got pulled a few days ago when this virus started causing a bit of havoc around the world. So unfortunately that got binned, but my missus saw that there was a 10k race in Pontefract this weekend over in West Yorkshire. So she said, "Do you fancy entering it?" So I thought, yeah, what the heck, I've trained quite a lot, and ended up coming 28th out of 1300 runners, which was really good. Pretty, really happy with that. It's not bad for an old bloke, because I'm 50 years old now, and managed to finish in 39.15, which is what I was hoping for, just to get under the sub 40s. You know, I'm still pretty competitive when it comes to sport, which might surprise a few of you, because I'm not competitive at all when it comes to fishing. You know, the thing is with fishing, I've been around so long now in this game, and I know that, you know, you get your day. It might not be today when I catch a few, it might be the next day, it might be the time after that. Everybody gets their go, you know, that's what fishing does. It's something that we can all be successful at once you've cracked how to do it. You know, if I stuck my nan, who knows nothing about fishing, on Euro Aqua and gave her my rods and she cast out, the chances are she could get a world record carp on the end, and next minute she could be world record holder. You know, that's what happens in fishing. But when it comes to sport, you can't be like that. You know, there's no luck that's going to get you to be the world record holder. You've got to put the training in, you've got to put the hours in, and you've got to have a little bit of talent. So when it does come to sport, I get a little bit more competitive. So you know, I always set myself little goals and milestones, and when I got on that start line, I thought, yeah, let's try and get a sub 40 today. So to get a 39.15, proper happy with it. But yeah, legs are aching now, so it's good to be sat down, and it's good to have fish in front of me. So 48 hours in front of me, let's hope we can catch one or two of them. I'll put first light for a bit of fish spotting, but that is not a good sign. Frozen land, isn't it? Freezing cold night, but the weather is due to change today. It's going to be a bit of wind coming and apparently a bit of rain. So unless I catch anything in the next 3 or 4 hours, because they're completely motionless, then I think I'm going to have a move to the far side, because in the week there was a lad who fished in peg 4 who had a 41 common and a couple of 30 pounders as well. So I know they're definitely getting caught from over there, even though I was seeing them over here yesterday when I was setting up. So see how it goes. We're only here for 48 hours, so with almost 24 in the bag and no fish, you need to do something. So I'm always prepared for a move, so that's what I'm going to do. I'm just looking at myself in that camera screen and it looks cold, and that's because it is cold. My feet are like ice blocks at the minute, but at this time of the year especially, because they haven't fully woken up yet, they can be very, very particular about where they pick baits up from. So if you find an area on the lake where they're getting caught from, the chances are, unless they move out of that swim, then once you get in there with a different bait or whatever you're using, even if it's different to the other guy, the chances are you're still going to catch them. So that's what I've done, and I hope it pays off. Can't say it's going to, it hasn't done yet. I've just got the rods out, but if I catch something out of here, then I think I've proved a point that it is a case of getting in the spot where they're picking bait up from. But you know, I've got 24 hours left now in this swim. It's still raining, it's still pretty miserable. This time of the day, which is, let me just have a look, I think it's about R4. I've been told there's a chance of a bite around about now, but first thing in the morning is the best time, sort of up until about 10 o'clock in the morning. So that's when I'll probably be giving it to, and then I'll see what I'm going to do. It's in that period at the moment when the old coronavirus has been striking, so I don't need to do too much running at the moment. I haven't got a marathon now until October, November time, so I haven't really got to do any sort of serious running, which, if I'm honest, as much as I love me running, in these conditions I'm not really going to miss it, because it's wet and damp and miserable, and I'd rather sit on the rods, because bite time on this venue, definitely from speaking to some of the locals down here, it seems to be a lot better during the day. So yeah, sit on the rods, see what happens. So I've got 24 hours ahead of me now, and if it doesn't pay off in this swim, then I probably should have stuck in the other one. But that's carp fishing, innit? You gotta be in it to win it. So we'll see how we go. Big old round one, this one. Big old fat lump, and if I'm honest, when it first popped up in front of the net, I saw the shoulders on it. I thought, yeah, that'll do. But it's not got quite the length of a really big fish, but either way, that is a brilliant start. This month's product plug is the Safeguard landing net from Avid. Now, I've been using this net for almost 10 months, and it's a lovely bit of kit, very lightweight, which slides through the water beautifully when netting fish. There are a couple of options available, either with a one or a two piece handle, both featuring Japanese shrink wrap, and both of which have a standard 42 inch net. Now, it's very easy to assemble, and there's a durable slimline CNC spreader block which is built into the handle. I've had loads of fish in this net, and not only does it do the job, it looks the part. Everyone loves a bit of camo, and that mesh just looks the absolute nuts. If you shop around on the net, you'll pick one up for as little as 90 quid. So for more information, check it out at avidcarp.com. Just listen to that. If you're wondering what I'm on about, it's nothing, it's silent. This really is a lovely place to be. It's so far away from roads and everything else that's going on in the normal world. It's a beautiful place. I can hardly hear anything. I could just hear the other anglers on the other bank, but it really does smell as well really nice. It's that time of the year when things are starting to come to life. It's a great time of the year to be on the bank. And if I'm honest, last year I had a couple of goes on here and I didn't really like it, and it wasn't because of the venue, it was mostly because when I came down here it was really busy. You know, there's so many nice fish in here now, and they're all growing really well. It became a real busy ticket, it's really sought after. But this year, Rob and Ed Matthews, who runs the place, have decided to up the ticket price and reduce the number of anglers down here. There was a time last year when I came on here when nearly every swim was taken, and if I'm honest, a couple of times because I'm getting older nowadays. I'm not that old, I know I'm not that old, and I don't want to sound like an old grumpy man, but as you get older, you tend to try and seek different things from your fishing. And you know, I've got the snow carp in the album, I've got all the doubles, fished all the rivers, canals, fished for big fish, caught a few, blah blah blah. And the one important thing now in my fishing is that I like to fish venues that are just nice to be at. You know, I did a blog last year on Acton Burnell, who you might have seen it, and it's on the YouTube channel. And that place is somewhat special, it really is. It's so remote and so beautiful to just be there. And although this place is stunning, it was a little bit too busy for me. But you know, and as you get older, you sort of you want something different. You know, I'm getting to that stage now where I like to have a little bit of solitude and like to have a swim between me and another angler. And a couple of times I ended up getting woken up early in the morning on here and last thing at night. And I think as you get older, you have a little bit more respect for other people, because I won't nowadays go and fish right next to somebody. I'll look for a spot that's well away from them, and I'll also know when not to go round into somebody's swim. You know, I certainly won't wake them up at 6 o'clock in the morning, and I won't be knocking on the bivvy door at half past 10 at night. You know, people work different shift hours to a lot of people, and you know, we all work different shift hours, I should say, and everybody goes to sleep at different times. So you know, there's a little bit of etiquette in carp fishing that I won't say it's disappeared, but certainly as you get older, you expect it a little bit more when you're on the bank. Because I come from a generation where there was carp fishing etiquette in the early days that I started carping, and I'm not saying I complied with it, because when I was younger I was a lot different angler to what I'm like now. Didn't sort of notice it until you get a little bit older. And you know, nowadays if somebody's setting up in a swim, I won't go around and talk to them, and if they're packing down, I won't go around and talk to them, and I certainly won't go around when they're eating their dinner. And I won't sort of cast out unless I've gone and had a word with whoever's next door to me either side and found out where the left hand rod is or the right hand rod, and I'll give them space. You know, that's how I am. And you know, it is an important part of carp fishing, I think, and it's something that's I wouldn't say it's a dying breed, because there's plenty of guys around who are my age and grumpy old men like me. But certainly as carp fishing's become a bit more mainstream, it's on telly and that, there's a lot of people who've coming into it straight from TV and that, and it does make it a little bit difficult for people like me to fit in on certain lakes, certainly the lakes that are very busy. But you know, there are places, thanks to Rob Ailes and fisheries like that, that you can escape it. And hopefully this year on here, now it's been reduced in numbers, it's going to be just like Acton is, which is just a mega place to be. Well, just redone the rods after a quiet night, and just landed that lump, which definitely looks like it's another decent kipper. So let's get it weighed in. Another mega fish. And this one looks absolutely gorgeous. The colours on it are fantastic. It's got a really weird trait, which I'll show you in a minute, that its left-hand eye is almost like Popeye, but that is a chunk. And it's a very typical RH Fisheries carp, this one, because it's very broad across the shoulders and quite short really in length. If you saw the shoulders when it came up in front of the net, it did look a lot bigger than what it's actually weighed. It's weighed in at 28 pounds, but mega, lovely start to the morning. And this is his Popeye side. his eye is really bulging out. I don't know if you can see that. Perfectly healthy, lovely carp, and a great way to start the day. Tell you what, it's proper cold here at the minute. It's not that cold temperature wise, it's probably about 14 degrees, but there's a really biting cold northerly wind and it's blowing straight down the lake into my bivvy. So I'm just stood to the side of it, but yeah, I've got about four different layers of clothing on at the moment, so I'll probably look about 20 stone, but it's definitely worth being out here because the fish are feeding. They're still in those little pockets that you tend to see, because I've had nothing on my right hand rod and I've actually just reeled it in a few moments ago and put it quite close to where my left hand rod is, because I know the guy who was in this swim before me, he was catching his fish from pretty much the same area where I've had those two from. So, you know, it's definitely worth trying to find where those pockets of fish are in front of you, you know, casting around and giving it half an hour or so in different spots to try and find where they are, because they've not fully woken up yet. It is only, what is it today? I think it's about the 12th of March, so it's not too late. It's only just been a two or three days of decent warm weather, so although the fish are getting caught, they're not really out of that winter sort of mode just yet. But yeah, it's cold being here, but I'm happy being here, so let's hope we get a few more fish before I leave. Well, it's finally stopped raining, and although the wind's still blowing, it's thankfully drying the gear out. The bivvy behind me is almost dry, but it's been a good session. I've been down here for just short of 48 hours, so, you know, for my first trip of the year this year to this venue, and not really knowing a great deal about it, and I certainly am no regular on here, to come down for a one-off trip for 48 hours and manage to get myself a couple of nice fish, I'm really happy with it. But, you know, it's been uncomfortable, it always is at this time of the year. The weather conditions are always a bit up and down. One minute it's warm, next minute it's cold, and it does send the fish all over the place as well. You know, they've been active, but they've been hard to tempt. You know, I had a lot of fish in front of me in the first swim that I started in, but in this swim that I'm in now, if I'm honest, I've not seen anything in front of me, but I've managed to catch a couple. So thanks to Ed for giving me the information that the fish have been coming from over this side of the lake. So all in, it's been a good trip, and now all I've got to do is get packed away, get myself off home, and thank you all once again for watching my blog, and I hope to see you again in a few weeks' time for my next one.